So, hi, and welcome back. I hope the summer has been cool for you. Let me share the screen. There you go. Hey. Hang on, something got lost here. Where is this? Hold on, I lost all the picture of you guys. All right, please look at things. So, first of all, let me wish you all Shana Tova and a happy and healthy new year and well over the fast. So this year, I'm looking to change things up a bit. Instead of picking out movies, I'm going to call on you to let you know what you would like me to showcase. And this presentation is going to be a little bit different from previous presentations. I'm going to introduce more video clips to explain certain parts of my discussion. I have to admit that reviewing Hallelujah has made me step out of my comfort zone. And a comfort zone can be described as a psychological state in which things feel familiar to a person and they are at ease and in control of the environment, experiencing low levels of anxiety and stress. Therefore, it can be assumed that stepping out of one's comfort zone will raise anxiety and generate stress to a certain extent. Poetry, essays, and the arts are not really my forte. However, I am stepping into this one lock, stock, and two smoking barrels. And Leonard Cohen would not be my first choice. His writing is not for me, and his voice is too gruff, except in Hallelujah, where it fits perfectly. In advance, I want to apologize to Rabbi Levy, as I do have some clips featuring female artists. Okay, let's go to slide number two. So mark this date, Tuesday, October the 25th, for our next session. Netflix, I haven't picked any movies yet on Netflix, and when I do, I'll get back to you. Amazon. So the JCC has introduced a movie club and has selected four movies through December. This is the first movie I'll be showcasing next. Or for $21, you can view these new movies at the JCC. So this one is on Amazon, and at the moment, there's a $4.99 charge for the movie. The dark and twisted love story of King David and Bathsheba. Before we get into the origins and history of the song Hallelujah, it's helpful to know the basics of the backstory upon which the song is based. The scandalous story is a tale of infidelity and betrayal that would rival any scandal amongst celebrities and world leaders in the modern era. King David was the second king of what was known to us at the time as the United Kingdom of Israel and Judea. Bathsheba was married to another man, a soldier named Uriah. When David saw Bathsheba bathing on the roof, he was mesmerized by her beauty and asked that she be brought to him. He knew that Uriah was away at war, so the timing was perfect. David and Bathsheba began a passionate love affair, and eventually Bathsheba became pregnant. Desperate to cover up the scandal, David plotted a scheme to get Uriah back home so Uriah could sleep with Bathsheba. The idea was to try and pass the baby off as Uriah's child. However, Uriah had other plans. He wasn't ready to leave the war front because it was still waging. And since he wouldn't return home, David had Uriah sent to the front line so he would be killed. And that's exactly what happened. Abuse of power. Ultimately, this story is about the abuse of power, all in the name of lust. And lust leads to adultery, murder, and brokenness. Until he fell in love with Bathsheba, David had been gifted. He had been a gifted and brave leader, but he started believing his good propaganda, a fate that befalls many great leaders. In short, David started taking what he wanted with little thought to the consequences. Historically, people have blamed Bathsheba for luring David with her beauty, but the fact is, David lusted after her, and there was a large imbalance of power in the relationship. As a woman in biblical times, Bathsheba had little power of her own. David and Bathsheba's legacy. David married Bathsheba once she became a widow. Unfortunately, the baby was lost in a miscarriage, and David believed that God was punishing him for committing murder and adultery. Eventually, Bathsheba gave birth to another baby, a boy who would become King Solomon. You can find the original story in the Bible in the book of Samuel, and it came to pass in an evening tide that David arose off his bed and walked up to the roof of the king's house. And from the roof, he saw a woman washing herself, and that woman was very beautiful to look upon. You probably heard Hallelujah, an incredible song composed by the late Canadian artist Leonard Cohen. The song has been widely performed and has been featured in TV shows and films. Hallelujah is one of the most iconic and popular songs. And the crazy thing is that the song was underappreciated for a full decade after Cohen wrote it. How did Hallelujah become so popular? And what exactly do the song's complex lyrics mean?
You look around and you see a world that cannot be made sense of. You either raise your fists or you say Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I was a young reporter.
Did Izzy freeze on us? Pinky, Izzy froze on us. Since you're closest.
Yeah.
Yep.
All right, looks like he's coming back on Zoom in a minute.
Okay, a little glitch, everybody. Hold on.
Rejection of an owl ever in paid for. That's pretty extreme, yeah.
It was crushed after that.
Izzy, you're not sharing your screen anymore, so we don't see it.
Yes. What did I say?
We can't see what you're showing.
We can't what?
We see you.
I see you, Izzy, but I don't see anything else.
Okay, hold on a second. Okay. Where's the presentation?
Number six.
You look around and you see,
see
a world that cannot be made sense.
You don't see the screen?
Either raise your fist.
No, we see your PowerPoint, but not your actual presentation.
You want number six.
Okay, sorry about that.
I was a young reporter for Rolling Stone magazine in 74.
Of course.
A piece on Leonard. He's so gracious. He was always a spiritual seeker.
Unlocking the mysteries of life was his primary preoccupation.
Sitting in a meditation hall for 4 or 5 hours a day, you kind of get straight with yourself.
Yeah, it's often starting with this song, first from coffee, then working on Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. It was a lot of verse. The number 180 comes from a
real song group that comes. No one knows that is grace that is a gift. Tommy Records wishes to put it out. The rejection of an album after it's paid for. That's pretty extreme, yeah.
He was crushed after that.
The first version of Hallelujah was Jeff Buckley.
Jeff Buckley. I remember John Cale covering that song. And I remember going, wow, a lot of people know that tune. Just Cale, then Buckley, and then Shrek. So Shrek really broke it.
And even though it all
Hallelujah really beat the odds in that it's own thing now and it has its own life.
I think he was tickled pink that everybody in their sister was singing the song.
You're getting things that are so deep and so resonant in your own spiritual journey that you are benefiting from his.
Sorry for that mishap. So what is it about the once virtually unknown song that inspires so many musicians to make it their own? In June 1984 in New York, Leonard Cohen laid down a song he'd spent years writing. Hallelujah would eventually join the pantheon of contemporary popular music. At the time, though, the Canadian singer-songwriter may as well have dropped off the end of the pier. That's because it was included on various positions. Cohen's seventh studio album, Columbia, which the head of the music division, Walter Yetnikoff, chose not to release in the US. Leonard, we know you're great, but we don't know if you're any good. Or as a cartoonish exec say in the movies, I don't hear a single. The album, which Columbia didn't put out in the US until 1990, features a handful of Cohen's greatest songs. It opens with a sardonically gorgeous dance to the end of love and fades out on If It Be Your Will, which Cohen described as an old prayer that he was moved to rewrite. And sitting in the middle of that albatross of an album, side two, track one, is one of the most frequently performed and recorded pop songs of the past half century. As any American Idol watcher or bar karaoke singer knows, Hallelujah begins. Now I've heard there was a secret chord. And for a time, the universe seemed determined to keep all of the song's chords a secret. In the new film, Hallelujah, Leonard Cohen, A Journey in Song, documents and records the long and strange trip to ubiquity. It's a tale about the vagaries of the recording industry and the foolishness of industry suits, but is also about rediscovery and inspiration and reinvention. Hallelujah has become inescapable in large part because it doesn't narrowly belong to anybody. It belongs to all of us. Leonard Norman Cohen was a Canadian singer-songwriter, poet, and novelist. His work explored religion, politics, isolation, depression, sexuality, loss, death, and romantic relationships. He was inducted into the Canadian Music Hall of Fame, the Canadian Songwriters Hall of Fame, and the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. He was invested as a companion of the Order of Canada, which is the nation's highest civilian honor. In 2011, he received one of the Prince of Asturias Awards for Literature and the 9th Glenn Gould Prize. Leonard Norman Cohen was born into an Orthodox Jewish family in the Westmount, in Westmount, Quebec, on September the 21st, 1934. His Lithuanian mother, Marcia Klonitsky, emigrated to Canada in 1927 and was the daughter of a Talmudic writer and Rabbi Solomon Klonitsky Klein. His paternal grandfather, whose family also moved from Lithuania to Canada, was Canadian Jewish Congress founding president Leon Cohen. His parents gave him the Jewish name of Eliezer, which means God's helps. His father, clothing store owner Nathan Bernard Cohen, died when Leonard was 9 years old. The family attended congregation Sha'ar HaShomayim, to which Cohen retained connections for the rest of his life. On the topic of being a Kohen, he said in 1967, "I had a very messianic childhood. I was told I was a descendant of Aaron, the high priest." Cohen was described as a Shabbat observant Jew in an article in the New York Times. Mr. Cohen keeps the Shabbat even while on tour, and performed for Israeli troops during the 1973 Arab-Israeli War. Well, for one thing, in the tradition of Zen that I've practiced, there are no prayerful worship and there's no affirmation of a deity. So theologically, there's no challenge to any Jewish belief. Cohen was ordained as a Zen Buddhist monk in 1996. And spent 6 years at the Mount Baldy Zen Center in seclusion. The Cohen began his career as a poet and a novelist. By the mid-60s, he turned his pen to the more lucrative work of songwriting, largely out of economic necessity. But he came to popular music just as the scene was undergoing a seismic shift. Thanks to the likes of Bob Dylan and Joni Mitchell, the audiences were starting to expect artists to write the material they performed, rather than playing songs written by others, the norm up to that time. Whereas Dylan's self-titled debut album from 1962 features just two original songs, his sophomore effort released the following year includes only two songs written by others. By the summer of 64, the change had become unmistakable. The Beatles' first two albums, both released in 1963, were amalgam of their own and other songs. Their third, A Hard Day's Night, is an original Lennon-McCartney material from top to bottom. The songwriter-singer pair had effectively been eclipsed by the singer-songwriter. When singer-songwriters also record their work, that version is called the original. takes on an almost sanctified status. It becomes the reference recording against which all others are inevitably compared. And when those subsequent versions are released, we call them covers. This oversimple model grants primacy based on authorship and chronology. So Dylan's recording of Blowing in the Wind is the original, while a massive hit for Peter, Paul and Mary, released a month after Dylan, is the cover. Never mind their version went to number two on the Billboard charts. Dylan never charted at all. But the original versus cover cannot adequately display the particular history of a song like Hallelujah. Nor can the word cover meaningfully apply to songs written before the mid-60s. Up to then, performing or recording a song written by another wasn't anything to take note of, but a given. Singers such as Frank Sinatra, Peggy Lee, and Elvis Presley were the interpreters of the great American songbook. They sang the standards, which is the third term missing from our discussion so far. Before originals and covers, standards were the songs written for others to record. Works such as Summertime or My Funny Valentine, for which there was no widely accessible reference recording, only sheet music and a dazzling array of versions. The term cover itself comes into use in 1966, the very year Cohen started performing his own songs, as well as the year a song of his was first recorded. That May, Cohen made a trip to New York, hoping to sell some of his work. He met with the folk chanteuse Judy Collins, who was looking for material. "I can't sing," she quotes Cohen, "and I can't play the guitar, and I don't know if this is a song." This indeed was a song, she told him. It was Suzanne, and Collins sang it on her next album, In My Life. It proved to be the first single from Cohen's debut album, Songs of Leonard Cohen, released soon after. Collins' Suzanne then isn't a cover. It's not a recording of another artist's original. Indeed, in a weird way, Cohen's own Suzanne is the cover, even though it's his song. Hallelujah also sits uneasily within the framework of originals and covers. When Columbia refused to release various positions in the US, the independent label Passport Records stepped in and only pressed a few thousand copies. In that incarnation, it failed to chart, and Hallelujah, the documentary details, dropped rather quickly from public view. Fortunately for posterity, a founding member of the Velvet Underground, John Cale, heard Cohen perform Hallelujah in a 1988 concert. "It knocked me sideways," Cale later said on a radio interview. When he was invited to contribute to the track to the 1991 Cohen album, I'm Your Fan, he chose the deep cut Hallelujah. Cale also chose to, in a sense, re-edit the song. Cohen's drafts ran to many, many verses. Various reports put the number at 15 to 180, which Cale combed through, retaining some of those that Cohen had recorded, mixing others, and pulling in several from the archives, the cheeky verses, as Cale called them. As a practical matter, the many verses of Cohen's Hallelujah mean that any singer can also be an editor of the song. Choosing the verses they want to perform is another way to make it their own. In a dynamic that we've seen before, John Cale's version, solo piano, underwriting his rich baritone, became the de facto reference recording 7 years after Cohen's original. Jeff Buckley, having learned the song through Cale's cover, created a haunting guitar version that has many admirers. His reading of the song is as gentle as Cale's is magisterial, suggesting the fragility beneath its surface. As the documentary reminds us, a trimmed down and G-rated version of Cale's rendition was used in a pivotal scene in the 2001 DreamWorks animated feature Shrek and performed by Rufus Wainwright. The movie made almost $500 million worldwide, catapulting the song into the pop stratosphere. It is estimated that Hallelujah now exists in 600 to 800 versions. The website Secondhand Songs hosts a database of nearly 500 of them. I'd argue that we now have so many, partly before there was an original, before folks had easy access to Cohen's recording, there were already multiple interpretations, each rising or falling, not by virtue of his connection to the songwriter or in reference to his recording, but on its own aesthetic terms. Hallelujah is the most recorded and performed title in history, tying the top with Yesterday by Paul McCartney. And I can understand why. Both songs are one-word titles, Hallelujah and Yesterday. Both have one word in the chorus. Both are performed at the same pace, which I'll explain later. And both are so lyrical, they gnaw at you and remain inside your head for a long time. The beauty of every rendition of Hallelujah is the fact that each and every performer's rendition is the same. There are no jazz, pop, rap, country, swing, and blues versions of Hallelujah. This is due to the brilliance of Leonard Cohen's writing. Almost four decades after Cohen put an end to his obsessive writing and rewriting, he laid down his version, then Hallelujah has managed to become the rarest of things, a contemporary pop standard. History and the meaning of the song Hallelujah. Hallelujah is one of the world's most iconic and popular songs. So how did Hallelujah become so popular? And what exactly do the song's complex lyrics mean? Essentially, the song tells the story of the Bible's King David and his love of his life, Bathsheba. But this song isn't about religion. Let's dive into the lyrics and learn about the history and meaning behind one of the most beloved songs in the world.
There was a secret chord that David played, and it pleased the Lord. But you don't really care for music, do you? It goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift, the baffled king composing Hallelujah.
I will be taking you through the original three of seven verses as composed by Leonard Cohen. Verse one, I heard there was a secret chord that David played and it pleased the Lord. This line in the lyrics introduces King David, and it mentions the sacred chord that David played on his harp. When David was a little boy, King Saul summoned him to play his harp, believing that the divine music would repel evil spirits from him. In fact, it was David's skill as a musician that earned him a spot in the royal court. So it was his first step in uniting the Jewish people and rising to power. The singer draws a biblical reference to when David played to flee evil spirits off King Saul, the first king of the United Kingdom of Israel and Judea. King David, the second king, is also credited for composing the Psalms that pleased the Lord. So what does this mean? But you don't really care for music, do you? David suddenly remembers who he's speaking to, and he realizes that God isn't all that impressed by his performances. Cohen even tries to play the same chord by narrating. It goes like this: the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift, to please the girl. And this is the genius of Leonard Cohen. In the first verse, he wrote, "But you don't really care for music, do you? It goes like this: the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift." So what does this mean? The fourth, the fifth, the minor fall. I was given piano lessons as a kid and didn't do very well at it. However, I do know the notes and some chords. I'm going to play a video, because I'm no expert in this field, explaining the meaning of these lines, the tempo in which to play, which in turn explained why each and every rendition of Hallelujah is played in the same manner. Leonard instructed the performers how he wanted the song to sound. Brilliant.
What do those lyrics in Hallelujah mean? Are they even accurate? What exactly are those numbers referring to? Now, of course, I'm talking about one of the most loved and maybe also one of the most hated songs, probably because it's been recorded and performed perhaps ad nauseum to some people. There are over 300 known versions of Hallelujah, but it all started in 1984 by Leonard Cohen on his album Various Positions, and initially nobody really even knew or cared much about the song. That is until John Cale recorded it in 1991, Jeff Buckley in 1994. And then its real claim to fame, it was in Shrek in 2001.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Shrek was 2001, you guys realize this? But it's always been interesting. There's that one phrase, it goes like this: the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift. What are we talking about there? Music has this really handy dandy little device that we call the number system. And the reason it's so handy is because it enables us to speak in a universal language that is not at all bound to a particular key. We can be in the key of C major. We can be in the key of A flat major or E major or A major or D major or G major, go on and on and on and on. It doesn't matter. When we use the number system, we can just say the same thing and it will apply no matter what. Here's why. When we talk about a key, let's keep it simple for the time being, and let's just use C major. We're generally referring to the question of what is the home base of the song. Now the chords themselves, the actual chord progression is going to move all over the place. It's going to go, right? But if this feels like it's where our song is complete, it's where it maybe starts and maybe it ends, or maybe it doesn't start or end, but it's simply implied that, hey, when we hear this, it feels like the resolution. It feels like we are finally at home base. That is usually the key that a particular song is in. The next step beyond that is where we get into the lyrics to Hallelujah. It goes like this: the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift. When we go beyond the numbers to denote the degrees of the scale, the next step is simply just building chords out of each of those degrees. See, the number system is incredibly useful because if I want to denote a chord progression, I can simply give the numbers of the chords and they'll happen the same way in any key, no matter what key we want to play it in. And this is where Hallelujah, the chord progression is literally in the lyrics. It says it goes like this: the fourth, the fifth, right? Okay, let's talk about what that actually means. Leonard Cohen originally wrote this tune in the key of C major. It's since been recorded in all kinds of different keys, but let's just go back to the original C major. Okay, so we have, that's basically, you know, the start. And let's go ahead and assign these values that he's talking about in the lyrics to the chords themselves. It goes like this: the fourth. What is the fourth? One, two, three, four. Well, that's F, okay? And we know that the chord that we built on the fourth degree of the scale was major, so F major. Okay? The next says the fourth to the fifth. Well, let's just move up from the fourth to the fifth of that C major scale. And we know that chord is also major. So we have the fourth, the fifth. Now, this is where it gets interesting. And you might go, well, is that accurate? Are the lyrics really describing what happens here? This is cool. Check this out. Then we say the minor fall. Now, the chord that happens on the minor fall is the sixth chord, which we know is minor. So, yes, it's a minor chord, but hold on. Minor fall. We went four, five, six. We simply just kept going up. So what fall? What does that mean? This brings up a very interesting point about harmony that goes beyond simply designating the values that we've been talking about so far. We can talk about four chords, five chords, six chords, minor, major, all this stuff. But the other side of it is, what do these chords kind of make us feel? What is the emotional value of these chords? I actually think there might be a couple of things at play here. Now, the emotional value, a minor chord can feel like it's kind of a depressing lowering of our mood altogether. We have this hopeful climb that we might want to hear a final resolution of build, 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 right? And resolve. However, what we get is this, a building, building, and then, oh, well, that kind of seems a little bit sad. It seems a little bit, almost like a little bit of a downer almost, right? So that could be one of the things that we're talking about with minor fall, right? Certainly when we look at the emotional value of this cadence of resolving, kind of not really resolving, but giving this kind of lowered emotional state of this minor chord, right? Because what follows is the words major lift. And the chord that we see with that is this. You go from here to here. Oh, we've gone from a minor chord to a major chord. And inherently we feel this hopefulness in these chords. We have that right there is absolutely an emotional lift, even though, just like minor, the movement harmonically was continuing up. Four, five, six, yet we said fall in the lyrics. Okay, well, emotionally that makes sense. And again, here we say major lift, even though the root motion is actually going down, but the emotional state of those chords is going up, right? So it's a great illustration of the fact that the number system and the actual description of what we're doing is one thing, but the emotional effect that our harmonic movements have can be totally different. Now, to touch again on the number system and how useful it is, let's take that same set of lyrics and apply it to a completely different key. Let's say we wanted to play Hallelujah in the key of E. We've been talking about E a little bit. Let's go ahead and play in that key. Let's identify our four once again. One, two, three, four. And it's major using the notes of that E major scale, right? So we have A major, that's our four, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift. Okay, so we can refer to a completely different key, the exact same set of words, because that's what our number system does for us. It's a universally applied language. It's a universal way to refer to any different key in music so that everybody can be on the same page. And this is particularly useful if you're playing with a group of instruments where some of the instruments are transposing instruments, for example, a B flat trumpet or a B flat tenor saxophone, or even a flat alto saxophone. Not all instruments refer to their notes in the same way that we refer to ours. That's a confusing thing. Maybe we should make a video all about that, because it's massively confusing, and when you're writing music it can become a whole thing. But this helps in that situation, because as long as everybody knows what key they are in relative to each other and everybody starts in the same place, now we don't need to come up with all these different names to say, oh hey, the saxophone, your chord over here is going to be, it's on the G sharp major. Oh, but over on the piano, that's actually D major. What actually is it? I don't even know. If we just tell everybody, hey, it goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift, everyone can be on the same page. Let's try it in A flat. The fourth, one, two, three, four, goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift. We can play just based on those lyrics because they use the number system and it's universally applicable. So to answer the question, are the lyrics to Hallelujah accurate? I mean, I would say so. They don't all refer to the numbers of the chords. And yes, there is a little bit of a counterintuitive motion when we say minor fall, major lift. But if we look at that as referring to the emotional state of those harmonic movements, then it all makes sense.
Several other biblical references are drawn into the second verse of Hallelujah. The verse draws inspiration from Samuel, verse 11, from the Bible.
Your faith was strong, but you needed your son, the baby, the mom, the baby, and Hallelujah.
When David saw Bathsheba bathing on the roof, it tested his faith. He knew that he was making a huge mistake in coveting this woman who belonged to another man. King David sleeps with Bathsheba, gets her pregnant, tries to cover it up by recalling Uriah on him. However, Uriah refuses to come home while his brothers are fighting the war. King David then instructs Uriah's general to move Uriah to the front lines in the hope he'll be killed. He does get killed there. Leonard Cohen points out the indecency of love and lust.
She died to a kitchen chair. She broke your throat and she cut your hair. And from your lips she drew the Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Tying someone to a chair could be considered a fetish sex play. Interesting is how he points it out to be a kitchen chair, which would be a very low position for a king to sit on. However, that's what lust does. The chair symbolizes the fall of King David, because a chair is in a much lower position than a throne. Cutting David's hair symbolizes David's loss of power, but ultimately, the strength that Bathsheba gained when her son Solomon was appointed as king. Also, the cutting of the hair refers to the biblical Delilah, who became friends with Samson so that she could learn the secret of his strength. She convinced Samson to cut his hair, and it turns out that the secret to his strength was his glorious hair. Verse 3, I leave this to your own imagination, own interpretation.
You say I took the name in vain. I don't even know the name. But if I did, well, really, what's it to you? There's a blaze of light in every word. It doesn't matter.
Third verse of Hallelujah, Cohen's deadpan wit returns, offering a rebuttal to the religious challenge presented in the previous lines. You say I took the name in vain. I don't even know the name. He then builds on the song's central premise, the value, even the necessity of the song, of praise in the face of confusion, doubt, or dread. There's a blaze of light in every word. It doesn't matter which you heard. The holy, or the broken hallelujah. A blaze of light in every word. That's an amazing line. Every word, holy or broken. This is the fulcrum of the soul as Cohen first wrote it. Oops. Sorry. I jumped a slide. Like our forefathers and the Bible heroes who formed the foundation of Western ethics and principles, we will be hurt, tested, and challenged. Love will break our hearts, music will offer solace, and we may or may not hear, but we will be faced with joy and pain. But Cohen is telling us, without resorting to sentimentality, not to surrender to despair or nihilism. Critics may have fixated on the gloom and doom of his lyrics, but this is his offering of hope and perseverance in the face of a cruel world. Holy or broken, there is still a hallelujah. To demonstrate the wide number of versions, remembering that each one is performed in the same manner. The first recording of Hallelujah, John Cale, 1990.
Heard there was a secret chord that David played and it pleased the Lord. You don't really care for music, do you? And it goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall and the major lift. The baffled king composing Hallelujah, 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 Hallelujah.
The second recording by Jeff Buckley. Other recordings of Hallelujah. Most viewed, Andre Rieu, over 44 million views. John Cale, over 24 million views. Jeff Buckley, 25 million. Andre Bocelli, Jennifer Hudson, Bon Jovi, Elvis Presley, over 20 million. Pentatonix, Susan Boyle, Celine Dion, the Canadian tenors, K.D. Lang, Lindsay Sterling, here in Phoenix. Carolina Prochenko on the streets of Prague, over 6 million. And at least 50 performers worldwide in America's Got Talent and The Voice. Just in the last couple of weeks, the young lady who won The Voice performed Hallelujah.
I heard there was a secret chord that David played and it pleased the Lord. But I don't really care for music, do you? And it goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall and the major lift, the baffled king composing Hallelujah, 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 Hallelujah.
Hallelujah in Yiddish.
Wenn ein Nigen wär soll, was Gott hat gespielt vor Gott, nur dir wird's nicht gewähnt, als er Jeschung. Und es singt er so, a fire, a soul, a mishaberich heit a kol, der duller meilach vet a hallelujah. Deine Munde ist gewohnt schwach, der Schäfer bot sich auf dem Dach, ihr heit die Lebunne, dein Refuge. Und sie nimmt dein Kopf, sie nimmt dein Kopf, sie schneit von deiner Haare zopf und zieht von Mäuel an Rot, oh Halleluja.
And Andre Rieu turned in an impromptu rendition at the City of David in Jerusalem in his recent tour. Rabbi, this one has woman in it.
So the first song that comes to your mind when you're here, when you're a musician, is of course the Hallelujah by Cohen. Perhaps being here, I ask Donay and Anna. That would be an idea. I'll do that. Donay? Anna? Hoe zijn jullie hier, dames? We are here, the City of David.
Yes.
And that it's really, I can feel, I can understand why Cohen was inspired to write this Hallelujah. Yes, would it be nice when you both sing some lines here of the Hallelujah?
Really nice.
Of course. Yes.
I heard there was a secret chord that David played and it pleased the Lord, but you don't really care for music, do you? When it goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall and the major lift, the battle thing, sing Hallelujah, Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah,
hallelujah. Thank you very much.
And Andre Rieu's live concert in Maastricht with over 44 million views online, the same singers.
I've heard there was a secret chord that David played and it pleased the Lord, but you don't really care for music, do you? Well, it goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall and the major lift, the baffled king composing Hallelujah.
And finally, in his last concert in Ramat Gan on September the 24th, 2009, Cohen spoke Jewish prayers and blessings to the audience in Hebrew. He opened the show with the first sentence of Ma Tovu. At the middle, he used the Baruch Hashem, and he ended the concert reciting the Birkat HaKohanim.
Israeli and Palestinian members of the Green Parents for Peace. And those other men and women, some of whom are called naive, foolish, irrelevant, defeatists, but no. Not at all, friends. They have achieved the victory, perhaps the only victory available, the victory. So dear friends, you were left with all, I don't know if you should have fun. Yahweh Adonai Tono Vilecha Mi Kunecha. Iso Adonai Tono Vilecha Mi Simlecha.
Throughout his career, he was always called Leonard Cohen, even though his manager suggested he change his name. Leonard Cohen said there's nothing wrong. Leonard Cohen died November the 7th, 2016, at the age of 82, at his home in Los Angeles. Leukemia was a contributing cause. According to his manager, Cohen's death was the result of a fall at his home that evening and subsequently died in his sleep. His death was announced on November the 10th, the same day as his funeral, which was held in Montreal. As was his wish, Cohen was laid to rest the Jewish rite in a simple pine casket, in a family plot, in the congregation Sha'ar HaShomayim Cemetery on Mount Royal. Tributes were paid by numerous stars and political figures. Citizens and officials in Montreal considered honoring him by naming a street and other locations, including a library, after him. The city of Montreal had a tribute concert to Cohen in December 2016, entitled God is Alive, Magic is Afoot, after a prose poem in his novel Beautiful Loser. It featured a number of musical performances and readings of Cohen's poetry. And as a footnote, Leonard Cohen also wrote a song, Who by Fire, referencing the Natana Tokev prayer, which we recite on high holidays, where God is compiling a list of who shall live and who shall die. Thank you. Okay. Okay, you can unmute.
That was very nice, Izzy. The performance I liked the best was the one in Yiddish, was the lyrics made more sense.
Yeah, it did. In fact, it actually did. But did you notice in every performance, the beat, the tune is the same? I know Pinky is going to be very happy. She won't be hearing it in the house anymore. Because I've been playing it over and over.
Delicious. I don't mind hearing
it. She says she doesn't mind. So Leonard Cohen was a very complicated person. Unfortunately, the movie didn't take off at the movie houses. I guess that in the next couple of months, it will come on to streaming. When I do find it on streaming, I will let you know.
Izzy, I'm reading a book about Leonard Cohen. It's called Who by Fire. And it talks about his really pilgrimage to Israel during the Yom Kippur War.
Right.
It's fascinating because it turns him around.
Correct. So the reason at the age of 60 that he went back on stage is because, like most other artists and sports people, the manager stole all the money and he had no money to live on. So he went back onto the stage at the age of 60 and he performed until he was 81 or 82, making more money in those years than he ever made. Every single concert that he played at was sold out. And the recording of Hallelujah is just, as I mentioned, one word, Hallelujah. In the lyrics, the fourth, the fifth, the minor, he told everybody how to play it. He actually instructed them how to play it. That was his brilliance.
Well, I think it's wonderful that it was picked up by so many different people. That's what really made it special, because it wasn't just him singing, but everybody else too.
You saw from the clips that I played how the audiences participate in song. It's I don't know if we should call it a prayer. I don't know if it's a song of hope. I don't know if it's an enlightening song, but it's one of those that eats at you.